After general equilibrium, now we are into welfare economics. All right. Okay. Now, the word welfare, as I think, that welfare is a word which is inherently subjective in nature. So, whenever we hear the word welfare, whatever notion that may come in our mind, okay, it is inherently subjective. Down the line, it assumes some form of justice that we hold in our mind. Now, we are in microeconomics, and to be very specific, microeconomics is an objective science, at least to the extent we have covered it. And so, the first problem with this word welfare is that how to break it down, okay? So, how to proceed to have an objective discussion regarding welfare. That's the first difficulty. Now, that difficulty of having an objective discussion, okay, that itself says that if we want to break down the subjectivity in different form, in objective terms, so what we are talking about is definitely different ideas or different ideas about what constitutes welfare. So in a sense, we are talking about alternative choices. Okay, so we're talking about alternative choices. And choices of what? So to that respect, we will have alternative choices of something which is called social welfare function. Okay. So we will use the acronym, that is SWF. So whenever I will write SWF, that will mean social welfare function. All right. So here we'll face different social welfare functions, and each of them will inherently have some form of value judgment, some sense of what welfare means with respect to that function. Now, obviously, it's a matter of choice which one to choose or which value judgment you actually like, but that is not the kind of discussion that we're going to have here. Here we have, we'll look at what social welfare function is and how it differs from the utility functions that we have discussed so far. Then we will look at three possible choices, okay, three which are famous. And then we will look into something which is called an SIC, so social indifference curve, which are generated from SWF and which are, in essence, which have the same kind of motto or message inside like IC, although characteristically they are a bit different, but the idea of drawing them and obviously the idea of using them, they carry the same things. All right, so that will be our first session, and then we'll move on to, in the next session we'll move on to something called UPF, then GUPF, and then we'll be able to maximize the social welfare. All right. So again, I'll say that within the choice of SWFs, which one to choose is a separate topic. Okay, it's a separate matter of discussion. And to the extent of this question, which one to choose, right? We end up in something called a voting theory. So the idea of democracy that is there in our mind, it says that let's have a vote, since if you have a confusion and since it is about the society, the idea of voting directly comes in our mind, right? I mean, obviously in a democratic setup. Now with regard to voting theory, then again we are faced with another question. That question is very serious. That serious question is, which kind of voting, okay, which kind of voting reflects society the best. So which kind of voting reflects society the best? And I don't know how you feel, but if you study it, you will see that there also we will say that majority voting is not really the best way of voting. But anyways, that's a different matter. It's an entirely different subject. You will study it in masters and it will come either as an extension of studying game theory, or it will appear as a section of a more difficult topic, which is called social choice theory. And within that social choice theory, you will find the work of Amartya Sen. Okay. Now, so these are the extension. Also, I must say that since you have studied general equilibrium, one of the paper that we'll have in the next year, that is international trade, that also kind of starts with this general equilibrium, where instead of two individuals, you can easily consider two countries, and you can ask this question whether and how trade benefits and to whom, and are there individuals whom trade does not benefit, and if it does not, then what to do. Okay, so this is something like it's like a gateway to a whole lot of subjects related to microeconomics. Also, you'll see that we haven't talked about something called externality, which we assume to be not to be there in welfare theorems, something that we will take up after studying welfare economics. Okay, and it is also will be better to think of general equilibrium and welfare economics as a combined topic. Okay, it's better not to treat them separately. All right, now just mention that to have SWF, okay, one of the important idea that we have used throughout the microeconomics is that we have always taken this representative individual, or the average individual, or average man, as it was first coined, right? Okay, average individual, someone who represents everybody. You can argue on that, but that was the basis of our starting, right? When we started consumer behavior, we always said a representative individual. And after that, whatever we have done is basically based on an individual, his choices, his income, you know, his options and all of that, his preferences. But in SWF, for the first time in microeconomics, we are talking about society, right? And society means a lot of individuals with their own preferences, with their own availabilities, choices and everything. And that, allowing that, actually asks us to kind of liberate one of the restrictions that we have put in the consumer behavior theory. And that is interpersonal comparison. We have said that we are using ordinal utility, and ordinal utility is something that does not allow interpersonal comparison. So the idea or the philosophy behind satisfaction there was very individualistic, right? But here, since we are talking about society, that individualism is not going to work. So if I were to construct a function which will represent the society, it is necessary that I make some form of comparison among the individuals who are involved in a society. Okay. All right. So for the first time, since you are studying micro, this is the first time we are allowing for differences among individuals. Okay. And also by that, we are allowing interpersonal comparison. Now, if I allow interpersonal comparison, that said, it readily takes us to cardinal utility. So to have interpersonal comparison, you cannot limit the theory within ordinal utility. You have to proceed to cardinal utility. Okay. Now, we ended with GE with saying that, the welfare comparison is not really possible within the Pareto efficient world. Now we are going to look at something called Pareto non-comparability. Given the alternative within an Edgeworth box, okay, let me draw an Edgeworth box and let's talk about, let's say, what we want to say in a more, in a clearer way. See, whatever we are going to do in welfare economics, it is kind of half philosophy and half mathematics. So both are equally important for what I'm going to say and what I'll be writing. Okay, so let's take a look at a very old diagram, a diagram that we have constructed earlier also. So this is, let's say, our Edgeworth box, okay? And I'm not marking any origin. Let's just say that this is one of those initial allocation, and we have ICs, okay, which are convex to the origin. And then let's say we have this contract curve, which goes like this, okay? And we know that starting from E, M1 is a point, M1 and M2 are two points beyond which we cannot go, keeping the idea of Pareto efficiency and searching for more efficient points, and also being at E1 and E2 are the same thing. All right, so we identified also this region as core. Okay, now we also said that we can have one point here, which is Pareto efficient, and we may like it because it is at least more equitable, right? But we also said that within the core, this portion of the contract curve, that is M1, M2, Pareto efficiency itself doesn't say where we will end up. But with a specific allocation, yes, we can find that mathematically. Now we are going to look at, as I said, Pareto non-comparability. See, when I'm talking about, so Pareto non-comparability. Okay, so when I'm talking about welfare, what I'm saying is that, you see, all points within the Edgeworth box, we have said all of them are feasible. So as a society of these two individuals, we can achieve any of these points. But if I ask in general, which point within this Edgeworth box is the best point, then Pareto efficiency has no answer. And that is the problem which brings us to this question of welfare. All right. So there are two kinds of non-comparabilities which we'll be looking into. Okay. And those two will tell us why we need this notion of welfare. So number one is that, you see, obviously points within core are Pareto improvements over E1, right? Of that we have no doubt, correct? That obviously being at M1, we can increase person 2's utility, and being at M2, we can increase person 1's utility, and at B, we can increase both the utility of both of them. Now, points within core are Pareto improvements over E1. So of that we have no doubt, but if I ask that, let's say this is a point, let's say some E3. Now, what about E3 and M1 and M2? So what about E3? So about E3 and the core. Of that, we have no answer. So when I'm taking an initial endowment, the region of that constitutes the Pareto improvements, okay, that are comparable to the initial endowment, but not to the other points outside the core. We cannot make a comparison of efficiency of points which are outside this. We cannot really say anything about that. So if we start with E3, we will have a different core, right? So what I'm trying to say is that having the relatively efficient point compared to an initial endowment doesn't allow to compare with other points. So let's put it in a better English. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is that Pareto does not rank every efficient allocation, efficient allocation superior to any arbitrarily chosen non-efficient allocation. Non-efficient allocation. So we cannot compare these points on the contract curve with the points which are outside this core. Okay, we don't have really an ordering. Okay, there is the first, and the second kind, which I have discussed earlier also, which makes the problem even difficult. Number two is, so let's check the first one again. Pareto does not rank every efficient allocation, so that is this one, on the contract curve, superior to any arbitrarily chosen non-efficient allocation. So I choose any E3. I can compare this with this. All right. Okay. Now, number two. Number two is that no way to compare points on the contract curve, right? So you can do that. We cannot compare this point with B, or rather we cannot compare even M1, B and M2. We can say all of them are efficient, but if you ask which one is better, I don't know. When I'm saying that B is better, I am adding an idea of equity, or here actually I will say equality. So I'm saying that an equal distribution is more efficient, which is a value judgment, okay, which will not be liked by everybody. Anyway, so there is no way to compare points on the contract curve. I don't know within this contract curve which one is better. And that is the specific reason we are going to construct social welfare function. All right. So let's see what are the. Given what I've said about social welfare function, you can easily think the basic idea behind it. We are looking at an utility function. We're looking at an utility function which is comprised of utility of other all individuals in the society. So that's what SWF is. It's a function of utility functions of all in the society. Okay, now Given that, we will have some restrictions or some restrictions a priori, and one of them is, so we'll have one restriction, and that restriction is that it is increasing in individual utility levels. So you can interpret it in any way. I mean, you can say that we are assuming that everyone in this society is good, or you can say that that we are actually quite good in heart. So we are saying that, okay, it's fine. I mean, we're not going to kind of consider that there may be some people decreasing the utility of whom can be quite better for the rest of the society, right? And we are saying this because even when that is true, I mean, if you think that is true, then finding that part of the society again calls for another value judgment, which is very much difficult. So for the time being, we have good people. So it is increasing in individual utility levels. All right. And even considering that, we'll have enough complications. So the kind of function we are searching will look like this. So kind of general form. So how will it? So consider allocation X. Okay. So consider allocation X. Now SWF. I'm searching for SWF, which I'll say will look like this. So it'll be a function of utility of everybody. So when I'm writing M, this M is the number of individuals in our society. You know, that's how, that's why at times we say that population really matters, because if you have lesser number of people, then dealing with such a function is easier. But anyways, we are in theory, right? So, okay. And so this is the first kind of notation. And the second is that allocation X is better than Y if, so choosing the better, how? We will write that, see W, right? Okay, W stands for welfare. So W of U1 of X, UM of X is greater than W of U1 of Y. That is becoming quite, okay. Wait. Okay, so U1 of Y and then UM of Y. Okay, all right. Okay. Now, we will see some examples, yes, but what are we going to do? As I said, primarily we will deal with three different SWFs. Okay, so look into their mathematical form. Then we will consider each of them. So then we'll draw a diagram for each, considering two individuals and then we will look into the value judgments. So these are the three things that we are going to do now. Okay, so what are they? I'll write down the names of them and then we will look at each one of them. Okay, so the first one that we'll be looking at is either you can call it classical utilitarian, or if you want the name, so Benthamite, SWF. Yes, following the philosophy of Bentham. And then you have Bernoulli Nash. If in masters you study the bargaining theorem of John Nash, then you will see the Bernoulli Nash SWF again. Okay. And the third one, which is quite popular now, even to this day, it's quite popular. Okay. That is called Rawlsian SWF. You can look for Rawlsian justice. And just to mention, if you look at books of people like literary figures like Amitabh Ghosh, there also you'll find mention of Rawls. Even in economics, if you study, if you like to study books like Idea of Justice, then you will definitely find Rawlsian. Okay, so in the next session, we'll come and we'll look at these different SWFs and their corresponding SICs.